And the last speaker of the morning is Claudio, that is editing the wiki page at the last minute, like always.
Because people make comments that
I was telling the people here that in the first one of the first schools of Yambo, I spent the night before completely awake to do the release and this kind of stuff. I mean, I didn't sleep all the night before one of the Sekam schools. So, I mean, editing of the wiki page is perfectly okay. Okay, so now we have a more Yambo-centered overview on the electron phonon coupling in preparation of the ENSON that we will do this afternoon.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Andrea. I'm Claudio Attaccalite from Aix Marseille University. And let me start, thank Elena and Bartomeo for the previous talk that introduced all the ingredients, all the topics that I will speak about. So how to do calculation, electron phonon calculation with Yambo. So my point of view will be mainly on the role of electron phonon coupling in the electronic structure. Now, you have seen different things that you can calculate with the Yambo code, but in all the tutorial, we only speak about electrons. We never spoke about phonons or the coupling with phonons. But as you see in this picture, unfortunately, atoms moves, so you have to take in account this effect, even if because there are many physical phenomena that cannot be explained using only electrons. That many of them were mentioned before, from superconductivity, Joule heating, the electronic relaxation, and then the effect of phonon transport, the phonon motion that is one can visualize in the experiment, the current phonons, the Pearlin stability, but also there are interspectroscopy techniques that are related to the coupling of electron and phonons, like Raman. And today we will focus mainly on how phonons affect the electrons. And in particular, the electronic structure. The effect of phonons on electrons is they have multiple effects. For example, they can create kink, like in this figure here. So in this case, the bare band structure was a straight line. And due to the presence of phonon, there was the formation of this kink here that is due to the real part of the self-energy between electron and phonon. Or they can enhance the effective mass of electrons. That's also one of the reasons why they change transport properties. The electron phonon coupling is also responsible for the closing of the gap of the materials. This is the example of silicon. And also in some particular case, a material can also change color due to the temperature, due to the electron phonon coupling. And this is visible also in the spectra. This is the spectra of silicon at finite temperature. And as you can see, the temperature changed the shape, the intensity, and also the broadening of the peaks. So how we can describe this phenomenon? What we want to describe is really how the electronic levels change when we take in account the presence of phonon. So the coupling of the electron and phonon that was shown before by Elena and Bartomeo. And to calculate this effect, what we are interested in is the change of the electronic structure, the electronic levels with the temperature. And this change is due to the two different phenomena. One is really the electron phonon coupling, that is this term here. So that is the change of the electronic bands with temperature. But then there is also a second term, that is this thermal expansion term, that is due to the change of the bands, electronic bands with volumes, and that change with the temperature. This is something that you can expect because you know that when you heat a material, the material can tend to expand, like in this figure here. If you think about iron, you just put on iron on fire and then the iron expands to other materials. And so the expansion of the unit cell of the material also will affect the bands of your system. This talk is mainly centered on the electron phone interaction, but I will also explain you how one can calculate the thermal expansion. The idea of thermal expansion is that if you simulate your system at different volumes, this is the example of silicon, the band structure will change. So this is a change of the band structure of silicon at different lattice vector. And this change here can be related to the derivatives of the phonon modes that are these Grüning parameters that can be easily calculated by finite difference DFT. And so one can estimate this effect of the thermal expansion on the band structure and can include in the calculation. This is something that will be out of YAMBO calculation. So we have to do it with DFT and we will not consider anymore apart from this slide. Let me say that in general, the change of the electronic structure due to the thermal expansion for many materials is small compared to the electronic phonon coupling. But anyway, it can be important. There are cases where they are comparable. So you have to keep in mind that during this talk, we will not consider anymore this term, but you can calculate it with DFT. So let's go back to the electron phonon coupling. I will follow an approach similar to the one of Bartomeo. Let's say that I want to show you how you really calculate this object in the formula we are implementing in YAMBO. So we start from DFT, where you consider atoms at equilibrium at capital R. These are the equilibrium position. Fortunately, it's the same notation of Bartomeu. And then for small u, we consider the displacement of atoms respect to the equilibrium. So what we do, we expand. So you see in the previous slide also, we expanded this potential in term of the small u up to the second order because we are working on solids. And so we are, for the moment, we are interested in harmonic approximation. So we only the oscillation close to the minimum of the atomic, the ionic potential energy. So this gives us an additional terms in the Hamiltonian that are these two terms here. That we can express in a second quantization way. For this, we will use the solution of the phonons that, as was shown, that we can calculate with density functional perturbation theory. So we know the eigen state of the atomic system, so that the eigen modes. And if we use this displacement, so the oscillation, the proper oscillation of the nuclei respect to their minimum position, this term here can be expressed in this way. That is the usual electron phonon coupling Hamiltonian that you can find in many books. And notice that for the moment, I just presented this term here and I didn't say nothing about the second term. I will come back in a moment to this second order correction. All these ingredients that we need for the calculation of the electron phonon Hamiltonian, as you see, can be obtained from density functional perturbation theory. In this theory that was presented this morning, you have an equation for the variation of the wave function with respect to the phonon displacement and the variation of the potential. Solving this equation, you have access to the dynamical matrix element that give you the frequency and the eigen modes of the atoms and to the electron phonon matrix element that this object G that will appear in the electron phonon Hamiltonian. With all these ingredients, we can construct a system of equation that couple electrons, ions, and they describe all the coupling with these two words. And in particular, thanks to the ingredient we get from DFTP, we can construct the electron phonon coupling matrix element and the electron phonon coupling Hamiltonian, that is this one. The phonon Hamiltonian, that is this other Hamiltonian here, where you consider like we consider phonon like boson, and the electronic Hamiltonian, that is the Cohn-Sham. In this case, we will consider the electron as an independent particle. And if you want to represent this interaction in terms of a diagrammatic way, the electron phonon coupling is this diagram. It's an electron with a momentum k that scatter with a phonon a momentum q and acquire a momentum and get a new moment that is k plus q. That is exactly what describes this term here. Now, these are the ingredients that will be used today. How we will use this ingredient? But let's see in a simple way. Starting from this perturbation theory, we can once we have defined our perturbation to the first and the second order, we can use a standard quantum mechanics approach that you can read in standard quantum mechanics books to calculate the correction to the energy levels. And if you use perturbation theory in both the potential that generated by the atomic motion and the perturbation theory in the wave function, the change of the wave function, you will see that the first correction to the energy of an electron are made of these three terms. So the term that is the average of this first order term on the ground state wave function, that will be zero because the ground state wave function for a phono modes is symmetric, if you want, is even, why the potential is odd. So we can, this term is zero. And then you have this term here that is the first correction of the wave function due to the atomic displacement coupled with the first correction of the potential. And the second order term that is the ground state wave function coupled with the second order perturbation of the potential. And these are exactly the so-called fan and the Biwaller term, that are the term responsible for the change in the electronic levels. Notice that until now, I didn't say how you calculate this second term here. I just say that from the densifactional perturbation theory, we get the first order term, but I didn't say anything about the second order. And for the second order, we will use an approximated version, approximated by Waller, that is based on this idea. If we image that the derivative of the Kohn-Sham potential respect to the mixed derivative of the Kohn-Sham potential respect to the nuclei IS and S prime are zero, so the so-called diagonal approximation, that is a good approximation for solids, but not so good for molecules. I will come back on this point. We can use the translation invariance of the correction to the electronic level to get a relation between these two terms, the term that the second derivative of the self-consistent potential and the first derivative of the self-consistent potential. What we'll do at the end of this term here, we will never calculate with density functional perturbation theory, but we will express it as a sum on some coefficient lambda that are function of the electron phonon matrix element G. So at the end from our DFTP, we will get to the G, and we will with the G, we will construct all the part of the self energy we need for the calculation. If you are interested on how much is good this approximation or when it fails, I advise you to have a look to this paper by Samuel Ponce, where they tested this approximation, calculating exactly also this term here, and they show that the fail is mainly, it happens only mainly in molecules, where this term cannot be disregarded. If we put all together this correction to the band structure given by the first order, the second order correction the potential, and the first order from the fan, and then we average on the ground state wave function for electrons and ions. That means for ions means average on the Gaussians that represent the phonon, the ion motion in the phonon coordinates. We get our correction to the band structure. That is this formula here. In this formula that is derived from perturbation theory, you can recognize that there is a factor here, B, that is the Bose function of the phonon modes that depends on the temperature. And here enter the dependence, the temperature dependence of the band structure. So it means that due to the occupation of phonons, the band structure will acquire a dependence on the temperature. And now how would this approximation works? Let's see with some example in compared with the experiment. But the classical or nice example that you can can think is the band gap renormalization of diamond. Diamond is an indirect band gap material with a very large band gap of 7 eV and with a very strong electron phonon coupling. And for this reason, when you calculate the renormalization of the gap, including electron phonon coupling, you get a renormalization of 600 millielectron volt. You can see here the red dots are the experiment, and also the blue two set of experiment, and the calculation are the black line that give you the renormalization. Notice that you can also try to calculate band gap renormalization using classical ions. So it means like with molecular dynamics. So you can imagine that you do a molecular dynamic simulation, you make your atom oscillate. Every time you calculate the gap, you average. And then you get the gap as function of the temperature. But then if you do a calculation this way, you will notice that the gap go at this value here. So the point is that the classical atoms, when temperature go to zero, they don't move anymore. So you get really the bare gap that is this value here. Why quantum atoms, even if the temperature go to zero, they sometimes you can continue, you can imagine that they can continue to oscillate, or if you want, they are delocalized. They are described by a wave function, not from a single point. And that's the reason we have this curve that doesn't go the straight line, but the curve go at finite value. And the difference between the limit of the classical ions, so the bare gap, and the gap obtained with the electron phonon coupling is exactly this correction here, 600 millielectron volt. Then you may wonder how a gap close. I mean, if conduction change, the valence band that change, or they change together. This is a much more difficult measurement, but some group were able also to measure the change independently of the valence and the conduction band using a smart idea that, and I want to show you here, is a X-ray spectroscopy. In this kind of experiment, you remove one electron from a core orbital and you promote it in the valence, or opposite, you fill the hole with an electron from the valence band that go to the core. So in these two techniques, X-ray emission spectroscopy and X-ray absorber spectroscopy, you can probe the position of the valence and the conduction band. And you can probe the position of the valence and conduction band also at finite temperature. And if you suppose, and it's not a bad approximation, that the core orbitals are less affected by temperature because they are bounded to the nuclei, more bounded to nuclei, you can try to plot the change of the valence and the conduction band as a function of the temperature compared with the theory. So this is the change of the conduction, the valence band. And the theory is the red line. As you see, that both change, but the slope is different. This is the case of silicon. So there is also the possibility to measure the change in the isolated bands. But okay, we can go beyond the standard perturbation theory, as we have done seen in this school, and use also, I forgot this one. And another point is that, as you've seen, the electron phonon interaction correction to the gap can be quite large. So when you get your, this is like a warning, when you achieve the result that is already on top of the experiment, like this is an old slide on 1997, you may wonder if really the result is good, because you have to always consider that the electron phonon interaction reduces the gap. So there is this effect to consider when you compare with the experiment. So this is perfect agreement. In reality, it's not a perfect agreement. And now we have seen all these results using standard perturbation theory. But since this school, we introduced the Green function and the Green function theory to do perturbation, you may wonder if you can use this approach for the electron phonon coupling too. And this is exactly the case. Electron phonon coupling can be reformulated in terms of Green function and diagram. And in particular, the part that you saw at the beginning that was due to the first order correction to the self-consistent potential give rise to this diagram. It is similar to the exchange. And the debye Waller, that this was a second order correction in the potential, give rise to this diagram here, that is in some sense similar to the Hartree term. If we look to the fan self-energy, that is this formula here, I will not derive it, but I strongly advise you this review from Giustino, where there is a very nice derivation and also nice reference. You can see that this formula is similar to the one we obtained by perturbation theory, with the difference that now in the denominator there are the phonon frequency. If you eliminate this phonon frequency from the denominator, you can see that you can sum up these two terms and you end up in the old formula obtained by static perturbation theory. So these are the additional dynamical part that you get from the Grebe function. Now, this dynamical part is important not only to get a better correction to the gap or to the electronic levels, that for sure it will do it, but also to get other phenomena, because when you have a dynamical self-energy, it gives you some electronic energy that are not real anymore. So you have also an imaginary part, a lifetime. And this is exactly what you get. If using the electron phonon self-energy, you reconstruct your Grebe function in this way, you can extract both the correction to the energy level and the lifetime. And in particular, you can plot also the imaginary part of the Grebe function, that is the so-called spectral function, that tell you how electrons are, what is the distribution of electrons that are not anymore a delta function, but they acquire some broadening that are their lifetime. So you have seen this for the electronic problem, but also for the electron phonon coupling problem is the same idea. Now, how this apply to real material? We can have a look on some particular case. This is, for example, is the top valence band of lithium fluoride from this paper of Gabriel Antonius. And you can see that you have a quasi-particle peak, that is this peak here, that is due to the crossing of the self-energy with the straight line, that is the bare energy, and also an additional peak here that is like a satellite-like peak that is due to the coupling with phonons. So part of the spectral weight will be transferred to this additional peak. This effect is even stronger for bands that are not top valence on bottom conduction. If I show you the band structure obtained using this approach, you can see that for particular bands like this zone here, bands begin completely diffused. So you can also lose the concept of a quasi-particle. It's really difficult to visualize a quasi-particle in some part of the Brillouin zone. And this is also visible in the experiment that measure ARPES when they get these diffused bands in the measurement. This effect of quasi-particle band structure are not visible only at the single particle level, but it has been shown that they are also responsible for some properties also at the optical level. And in particular, if I consider, I go back to the diamond, and I consider the quasi-particle band structure, the spectral function, if you want, or the bottom conduction bands here, and I use this two spectral function to reconstruct my dielectric constant in independent particle approximation, so it is a convolution of the Grebe function. That is not bad approximation in this case, because excitonic effects are weak in diamond, so it's not a bad approximation. If I use this Grebe function, this spectral function to reconstruct my optical properties, and I compare it with the experiment, I can see that there are oscillations, these are the derivative of the dielectric constant, that are not present in the bare calculation, so using only the shift of the levels that are the dot line here. So what it means that the spectral weight that is lost from the main peak of the quasi-particle and the redistributed around the main peak in this case, is also visible in optical experiment, as you can see in this experiment here. So now you may wonder, until now I show you only the effect of the electron phonon coupling on the single particle level. So you may wonder if you can combine the electron phonon coupling with the phonons, with electron phonon coupling with excitons. And this is possible also with YAMBO. If we start from our beta salpeter equation that you have seen in the previous talks, in this equation, you have a kernel that couple the different electron-hole excitation, and that are at the beginning are just valence conduction differences. And from this equation, you get the spectra of your exciton that you can represent, and from this spectra, you can get also the directing constant using this simple formula. But you are obliged to every time to add like a smearing to get a spectra that reproduces the experiment. These are just the peaks without the smearing, and these are the experiment data. So you may wonder if you can use the information from the electron phonon coupling to get the finite temperature spectra from the beta salpeter. And this is possible. It is possible in a simplified way, but it's implemented in YAMBO. You can use it. And the idea is to start from the beta salpeter equation and replace the bare energy of your electron with the quasi particle that you get from the electron phonon coupling calculation. So with a shift due to the shift of the bands and the imaginary part. If you use this procedure, what you get is an H0, it is the one that the Hamiltonian of the independent electron transition that contain also a lifetime, that is part here. Notice that now the final Hamiltonian is not Hermitian anymore, but doesn't mean that you cannot solve the problem. You can diagonalize your Hamiltonian and get your finite temperature beta salpeter equation, because you can repeat the calculation at different temperature. And with this finite temperature beta salpeter, you obtain both the dielectric constant, where now the electronic levels, the excitonic level, depend from the temperature and also the dipoles, and they have also a prodening, and also the excitonic radiative lifetime, that are the imaginary part of this excitonic level. If you put all together, you can reproduce some experiment at finite temperature, like here. This is a silicon at different temperature from 0 to 600 Kelvin. And you can also have access to other information, like how dipoles change with temperature, how the lifetime change with temperature, and so on. But you have to be aware, because this is an approximated treatment of the excitation phonon problem. So, and moreover, this is a research topic that is an open research topic. So there are different groups that are working on excitation phonon coupling. And the approximation that is implemented now in YAMBO is in general valid for not too strong bound exciton. And also that's a physical problem that the lowest exciton should have zero lifetime, while in this approximation has not. But okay, it's anyway a good approximation for bulk semiconductor, where there are not too strong bound exciton. In general, if you want to know more about exciton phonon coupling, I advise you this theory of exciton phonon coupling by Antonius and Liu, where there is, in my opinion, a clear derivation of the exciton phonon self-energy, and this other paper by Bernardi and Sangalli. And moreover, a new paper is coming out, and I didn't know the title, so I just put exciton phonon coupling revisited by Fulvio Pareari and Andrea Marini, that are still working in the developing of the theory to go beyond the present approximation and for the exciton phonon problem. Today you will have two tutorials. The first tutorial will be on the electron phonon coupling problem. So the goal of this tutorial is to calculate the renormalization of the band gap of a bulk semiconductor. Calculation will not be converged, but this is just to give you an idea how it works. In this tutorial, there is a first part on the generation of the electron phonon matrix element, because as you see in this presentation, you need, first of all, DFTP to calculate phonon frequency and electron phonon matrix element. this part will not be shown in the tutorial. Everything in principle is explained there, but it's a bit long, so you can run it in a separate moment. So the database are already present on the Wiki webpage, and you can start from that one for the calculation of the lepton phonon normalization. In this tutorial, there will be also a part on acceleration of the convergence of the result. Because let me say that the calculation of the electron phonon self-energy can be quite demanding, because you need a lot of K and Q point. We recently implemented in Yambo an approach to speed up this calculation. This approach is present in the GPL version of the code. The idea is to replace the self-energy that has a structure like this one with a part that is calculated on a coarse grid that are the matrix element that are calculated on this point here, and the part that is averaged on a fine grid where we calculate additional phonon energy and electronic energy. The additional phonon energy are obtained by quantum espresso with simple code that interpolate a phonon band structure in all the brilliant zone, and also the electronic energy are interpolated with some other technique. This approach works very well and speed up convergence. You can see here, this is the correction, the band gap of silicon versus the number of Q point with and without double grid. You see that with double grid, you have converged very fast, while without double grid, you continue to oscillate. This approach will be published soon, but it is available if you want to use it. And there are some files as example. Even if we will not perform a full convergence study, because it will require a lot of calculation of the electron phonon matrix element that is quite expensive. But anyway, we will provide some additional phonon grid if you want to test how it works. And in the second part of the tutorial, you will use the result obtained on the by electron phonon coupling, so the quasi-particle band structure, to calculate optical properties at different levels, at the level of independent particle and beta salpeter. So this will be the final idea, was to have finite temperature optics. So I think that from my side, this is more or less what I want to present on the Yambo code and implementation of the electron phonon coupling. The paper that describe the implementation are these three papers here. There are a lot of nice references on the electron phonon coupling. I advise you these two books for electron phonon and axion phonon. The review of Feliciano Giustino that is really well done. And the work on the review of Cardona on the Allen Cardona approach. This work of Samuel Ponce and Gabriel Antonius for the dynamical effect, the non-diagonal approximation, and all the approximation that are usually performed in the electron phonon self-energy, and this paper for the electron phonon axion phonon coupling, if you want to understand what are the limits of the present approach and that we will show you today. Okay. Yeah, that's my
contribution. Thanks a lot, Claudio. Really. Yes, so we have already a question here. Yes, for the student.
Thank you. Thank you for a nice presentation. I want to just ask you, you mentioned that the exciton phonon coupling in Yambo fails at a structure with strong exciton binding energy. But I know that there are some papers, for example, for boronitride, which has like 2 electron volts and more exciton binding energy. So what are the problems in it? What we should like check, if you can comment on it?
Yeah. The point is this, that the point is this, if you, when you write your beta salpeter equation, what you should have done in principle, you should include a new self-energy in the kernel that contains the electron phonon coupling, and then solve this new beta salpeter with this self-energy. That should be the perfect approach. With all the additional difficulties with energy dynamics. So this will be what the idea. And if you do like this, you can realize that the lowest exciton in a system that has a direct band gap, this was not the case of BN, but in general, the lowest exciton has to be a lifetime that is infinite, because at the end, when you create an exciton, the lowest one has not the possibility to decay in any other exciton with lower energy. That's the reason, for the one reason that he has infinite lifetime, if you want. Instead, if you introduce the imaginary part directly in the energy, like we do, you realize that also the lowest exciton has a lifetime. So it will require a broadening that is not, is too large, is exaggerated. Even if in the case like BN, the gap is indirect, so also the lowest exciton will have a broadening, but it will be, probably will be too large. On the other hand, the position of the peaks with the temperature can be correct, because in this case we just have a shift of the electronic levels, and that can be better described, let's say.
Okay,
so in my opinion, the wrong part is the broadening of the exciton.
Okay. So yes, the lifetime of the lowest exciton is open issue still. We don't know. I mean, it's debated. So there is someone that tells that it's zero. Me and Fulvio says that he says it's not zero. So it is, I mean, it's interesting because it's a really active research at the moment. There are three or even more papers that say different things. Okay.
So there is a question from the audience online. Davide Romanin, please, if you want to unmute yourself.
Yeah, hi. My question is actually, from what I understood now, we are only taking into account the optical limits, so we are not taking into account the exciton dispersion in the exciton phonon coupling. Am I right? So we are not taking into account the finite momentum of the exciton. Because as the speaker yesterday was telling us, for the exciton phonon interaction is also important to take into account the finite momentum for the electron hole couple of the exciton in order to correctly describe the exciton phonon interaction.
Okay, let's say that this term of exciton phonon, let's say that the exciton phonon has a different effect. You can have additional peaks that are due to the scattering with the phonons. So they are like if they were satellite of the exciton, in some sense, you can have the excitonic peak plus another peak that is an exciton plus a phonon plus an exciton plus a phonon, and so on. This kind of diagram are not considered. So we not to consider the scattering with the phonons that create additional peaks. In this approach, we just consider the broadening of an exciton. So we just if we give it lifetime, but not taking account the full scattering. So there will be, that's the way in which we can think is approximated.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. And another question, is there a way now in the current implementation of YAMBO to extract also the exciton phonon coupling constant?
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay.
Thanks.
Let's say that we are working on that and we hope it will be available in the future. So there is another question from John Hingal. Can you unmute yourself?
Yes. My question, thank you for the very informative talk. I'd just like to ask if, as a polaron can involve long-range screening, can polaronic transport be computed without support of a long-range hybrid functional such as
HSE06.
Claudio, are you there?
Ah, okay. Yeah, yeah, no, no. I'm reading the question on the chat. So I, Allah, I know that. Oh, Allah, let me be for the Polaron. I think you can calculate also without the need of long range hybrid function, because I remember this work about Giustino, that the reformulation of Polarons in the unit cell, and they were not based on a hybrid function. So I guess you can get Polarons without hybrid functions. You can check in the work of Giustino. They have done a very nice work on the calculation of Polarons. And I don't know, but as far as I know, for many materials, they got a very good result in comparison with experiment. But for sure, it will fail for others. But no, I think you can do it.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so on. Other question?
So first of all, thank you for your nice talk. Then if I properly understood, if you want to add the electron phonon coupling in a GW calculation, you just have to add the proper self energy to the electronic one, right?
But okay, let's say that this is exactly what we will do today. We will add the electron phono self energy to the band structure. That means you can add it to the GW calculation. In principle, if you want, there is an additional effect of the electron phono coupling, is that the electron phono coupling can change the screening of the GW, but this is not considered in YAMBO. Now, there are some work that consider also this other effect.
Okay, so can you please add some comments between the lifetime generated from the electron phonon coupling and the one that should be present due to the electron-electron interactions? So maybe one is higher than the other or stuff like that.
Okay, yes. As far as I know, the one of the obtaining from the electron phonon coupling is in general much larger than the one due to the electron-electron scattering. I don't know for, yeah, that's what I know in general. And then I think you can separate them using the temporal dependence, that the one of the using the electron-electron scattering is as a weak dependent from the temperature. So I think you can also extract both of them from the experiment. That is the, when usually when you see lifetime the electronic level, they are mainly due to the electron phonon.
So on this question, one comment is that the electron phonon lifetimes, usually they are proportional to the density of states. And instead the electron-electron lifetimes, which you have in GW, for example, they have a barrier to be activated, so which is related to the gap. So for example, if you are in the minimum of the conduction band, they are very low and then they increase because you need enough energy to activate them.
So maybe I can add something very... I mean, it's what I understood always. Maybe I can use the blackboard, because if you go on homogeneous electron gas, you consider a very simple case for a metal, and then electron phonon with a simple Debye model, where actually you have just one phonon branch that grows linearly. It's super simple. Then you can calculate the land width, and you get very different behavior. The electronic land widths are quadratic with the energy, so this is the gamma as a function of the energy, quadratic, while the electron phonon line widths are like this. So they rise in a energy step that is of the order of kBT, so of the temperature, and then they remain constant. So for low energy electrons, electron phonon is more important, but quickly the electron-electron becomes very much dominant. So, and indeed, this is connected to homogeneous electron gas, the density of states is constant. If you go to a real material, this thing changes a little bit, this thing changes a little bit, but the overall behavior is the same. So one grows quadratically with the energy, the other is pretty constant. So phenomenologically, they are really different. Another question?
So you are showing us the double grid technique to compute the self energy. So if I'm not wrong, you can do the same thing much accurately using, for example, Vanier functions, right? I mean, at every point you can compute the electron photon coupling. So what is the advantage of this double grid method over like, for example, the EPW does exactly the same thing, right? So, but much more accurately because you have electron photon coupling at each and every point you take. So what is the advantage of double grid?
No, I agree that using a Vanier function is better because you interpolate not only the energy of the electrons and the dispersion of the photons, but also the electron photon matrix element. So convergence is usually faster. Let me say that, so in general, it's faster. Let's say from a point of view of developers, implementing double grid is much easier. The advantage of double grid can be that you don't get Vanier function for higher conduction bands. And in case you are interested in converging the real part of the self energy, maybe you need more balance, more conduction band that you cannot interpolate with Vanier functions. That can be the advantage to have a double grid.
Yeah, so one more question. I don't know whether to ask this, but so if you consider the case of graphene, DFPT is pretty bad in describing the electron phonon interactions. For example, if you compute the phonons at K, I mean, there is cone anomaly where, I mean, DFPT couldn't properly take into account that due to the bad description of screening. So how could you improve like the electron phonon coupling or the phonons in these cases? I mean, I don't know if there exists any.
It has been different calculation for graphene, especially for the K phonons, so the gamma phonons. They get high symmetry phonons, so you can use also supercell easily. They show that functional that are hybrid can improve all correction from perturbation theory, but hybrid functional that are much easier to use, you can get a better electron phonon coupling for the K phonons, for the K point. Now, include this effect in a theory like this one is complicated. You have to really to do some approximation or use a finite difference, like complete a finite difference approach as shown before by Bartomeu. In this case, you can calculate electron phonon coupling by finite difference using a more accurate functional as a starting point. This has been done for superconductors, for other materials.
Okay, so I think we close the session now, and at 2, we have to be back in the info lab for the afternoon and so on. Thanks, Claudio, again.
Andrea.
Sì.
Andrea.
Daniele.
No, I suggest that.